गाइस, वेलकम बैक। माई सेल्फ पुष्पेंद्र सिंह एंड वी आर गोइंग टू स्टार्ट विद अवर डेली करंट अफेयर्स। सो टुडे यू हैव द 2nd of April 2021। ओके, एंड दीज लेक्चर्स आर बेसिकली मेंट फॉर दो स्टूडेंट्स विच आर प्रिपेयरिंग फॉर द सिविल सर्विसेज एग्जामिनेशन कंडक्टेड बाई द UPSC एज वेल एज अदर गवर्नमेंट कॉम्पिटेटिव एग्जामिनेशंस, बिकॉज यू रिक्वायर टू आंसर द फ्यू क्वेश्चन रिलेटेड टू द करंट अफेयर्स। फॉर दैट यू मस्ट स्टडी द नेशनल न्यूज पेपर। ओके, दैट इज you can read the Hindu, all right, or you can study your the Indian Express. Okay, both of these newspapers are equally good. You can refer any of these newspapers. Apart from that, you can supplement your preparation with the help of these lectures. Okay, these lectures are uploaded on the YouTube. Okay, on the day-to-day basis. So you can supplement your preparation with the help of these lectures. So you can subscribe our channel on the YouTube, where you will get these daily current affairs related lectures. All right. So let's begin with the lecture. Okay. So first is basically the Dada Sahab Phalke Award. As you know, the Dada Sahab Phalke Award is the highest award which has been recognized right in India in the cinema. So this year, the Prime Minister Narendra Modi have congratulated the Rajinikanth, who have been conferred the Dada Sahab Phalke Award for the year 2019. Now you must understand, this award for the 2019 was awarded to the Rajinikanth, right? It has been awarded late because of coronavirus pandemic. So the Rajinikanth is awarded, you know, Dada Sahab Phalke Award for the year of 2019, and Prime Minister Narendra Modi congratulated him, right, regarding this prestigious award in the cinema. So Dada Sahab Phalke Award is basically the India's highest award in the cinema. Okay, now regarding this award is basically presented annually at the National Film Award Ceremony. This National Film Award Ceremony is basically conducted by the Directorate of Film Festivals. It is basically an organization which has been set up by the Ministry of Information and the Broadcasting. So it is an autonomous organization within the Ministry of Information Broadcasting, which basically facilitates these National Film Awards. And under this National Film Awards, the Dada Sahab Phalke Award has been conferred to the renowned person who have contributed to the Indian cinema. And this year, 2019, the Rajinikanth have been conferred with Dada Sahab Phalke Award. Okay, now this award will be consisting of the Golden Lotus, right? It is also having the cash prize of 10 lakh rupees. Also, it will be having a shawl. Okay, this award is given to the person, right, who have outstanding contribution or who have given the outstanding contribution to the growth and the development of Indian cinema, right? And Rajinikanth is, all you know, is a superstar, is a mega star, right? Is a renowned personality, right? Everyone knows the Rajinikanth, and you also probably the fan of Rajinikanth. Okay, so the first such Dada Sahab Phalke Award was awarded in 1969. Since then, annually the Dada Sahab Phalke Award have been conferred. The first recipient of the Dada Sahab Phalke Award was a Devika Rani, right? She was the first lady of Indian cinema who was conferred this Dada Sahab Phalke Award. All right, so you can see these are the all portraits of the superstar Rajinikanth. Okay, superstar Rajinikanth, who is basically, right, a famous actor in the Indian cinema. All right, next, the lightweight bulletproof jacket. Okay, so these are basically the bulletproof jacket which will be used by the Indian Armed Forces. So this bulletproof lightweight jacket is being made by the Defense Research and Development Organization, right? Precisely, it is being made by the Defense Materials and Storage Research and the Development Establishment, which is nothing but a DRDO laboratory, which has been located at Kanpur. Okay, so the Defense Minister, who is Rajnath Singh, have congratulated the Defense Research and the Development Organization as well as its laboratory DMSRDE, which have made this lightweight bulletproof jacket for the armed forces. Okay, now this laboratory is located at Kanpur, Uttar Pradesh. It is a DRDO laboratory which has been basically working for the development of this lightweight bulletproof jacket. This lightweight bulletproof jacket weighs around 9 kg, okay, and it is basically suits with the requirement of Indian Army. So the front hard armor panel, right, which basically protect the armed personnel from being pierced from the bullet, right? So this front hard armed personnel is basically tested in the laboratory, okay, in Chandigarh, and it is basically met with the Bureau of Indian Standard, BIS standards, right? Specifications, which means this jacket is foolproof from the bullets. So this is basically the bulletproof lightweight jacket, weighting around 9 kg, 9 kilograms of weight. Okay. Next, the Kargil Zanskar Road. Now you must understand, the Kargil Zanskar Road is one of the high altitude roads, okay, which is been located in basically in the Union Territory of Jammu and Kashmir. Now, the Kargil Zanskar Road have been recognized or have been declared as the national highway, okay, in 2017 itself. So what is happening is that the Union Minister for the Road Transport and the Highways has approved a project for the upgradation of this Kargil Zanskar Road, right? And for that purpose, 780 crore rupees have been allocated for such project. Okay, now this upgradation, right, related to this Kargil Zanskar Road is basically facilitated in terms of the two laning of the Kargil Zanskar National Highway 301, which is being named after being recognized as a national highway, right? And under this, the EPC mode, that is engineering, procurement, and construction, right? This is the mode, or this is the model for the construction of this two lane, or upgradation of this two lane Kargil Zanskar National Highway. Okay, now as I told you that the Kargil Zanskar National Highway has been, or National Highway, which has been recognized as a national highway by the center in 2017 itself. Okay, this national highway basically, you know, start from the Zanskar Valley, which connects the Suru Valley and Sanku Valley of the Kargil Ladakh with the highway. Okay, now obviously this road will have, you know, the added benefits to the remote areas as well as the connected areas in terms of the economic development, social development, specifically connecting with the remote regions of the Ladakh region. Okay, so it is the two-lane Kargil Zanskar National Highway, which has been recognized by the National High, has been recognized by the center, and it has been approved a project for the upgradation of this highway. Okay, next, the Haryana amended rules of the procedure conduct of the business of the Legislative Assembly. Now, as you have seen that in various legislative assemblies, the normal functioning of the house is being, you know, deteriorated, right? Because of the opposition parties, because of some MLAs basically causing the ruckus within the house, right? Some are, you know, tearing down the documents or the papers or the bills in the Legislative Assembly chambers. Some are coming to the well of the speaker. Some are even, you know, shouting, and some are basically causing some more trouble to the functioning of the Legislative Assembly, right? So the Haryana Legislative Assembly have amended the rules, which is being related to the conduct of the business of the Legislative Assembly. Okay, so Haryana has amended several provisions, right, regarding the conduct of the business of Legislative Assembly of the state. Okay, under this amendment, several new provisions have been added, right? These several new provisions have been added in order to maintain the decorum of the house, right? So to maintain the decorum of the house, and also the prompt action can be taken against such unruly behavior, right, conducted by the MLAs within the house, right, which is being recommended also by the committee, which is being constituted by the speaker of the Legislative Assembly of Haryana. All right, now in the Rule 76, a new provision has been added in the conduct of the business of the Legislative Assembly of Haryana. Okay, according to the Rule 76, right, so for conducting any house, or for conducting any sitting of the house, right, there should be presence of at least two ministers, right? So this has made a provision that if there is some sitting is going there in the house, there should be at least two ministers should be present, okay? And which was not there earlier, right? Which was not maintained even during the discussion time, or even during certain calling attention motions time, which has been, you know, the procedural device for the conducting of the business of the Legislative Assemblies. Now it has been mandatory that at least two ministers should be present, right, during any sitting of the house. Okay, regarding maintaining the decorum in the house, what happens is a new provision has also been added, right? According to new provision, because the decorum should be maintained, right, which shows that we have the enough maturity in the functioning of the Legislative Assembly, being the largest democratic country in the world. Okay, so the new provision have been added. According to that, no member of Legislative Assembly shall tear off the documents in the House of the Legislative Assembly. That means even during the protest within the House, okay, no member will tear off any document, including the bills, within the House of Legislative Assembly. Okay, the new sub-rules 46 clause 11 also reads that, right, that for any member, right, for example, if I am the opposition member, right, if any opposition member want to have there some query or they want some specific reply from the minister, right, they should be writing down their question should be written down, right, in the page, and in the per page basis, not more than 150 words should be written down. That means in the page where the query is written, right, either it is typed or it is handwritten, it should not contain more than 150 words on the one side of the page, right? So obviously if you are putting extra words, obviously that will retard the clarity, right, what you are asking for. So per page 150 words is the limitation which have been made under sub rule of the conduct of the business of the Legislative Assembly. Okay, then as per the new definition, the leader of opposition, right, which is been means the leader of the legislative party, which is obviously been having the largest number of members, right, other than those party which have formed the government, right? So any opposition party which has been largest, or which is having the largest number of members other than that political party which have framed the government, okay, and whose strength at least equal to the strength of the quorum of the house, that is a 1/10 of the strength of the house. So this has been new provision have been added. Okay, next you have Baikal GVD. So Baikal is basically, it is a lake, it is the deepest lake, it has been located in Siberia, Russia. Okay, so the Baikal GVD, it is been, GVD means gigaton volume detector, it has been a telescope. So the Baikal GVD, it is the third such neutrino telescope. So it is an underwater a telescope which has been installed in the Baikal lake, right? Obviously the purpose of installing this telescope is to study, right, the most fundamental particles which are known as neutrinos, right, as well as to detect their sources. So the Russian scientists have installed, right, the world biggest underwater neutrino telescope under Lake Baikal in the name of the Baikal gigaton volume detector, right, obviously in the lake of Baikal, which is the world deepest lake situated in the Siberia, Russia. Okay, regarding this construction of this world largest or world biggest underwater neutrino telescope was begun in 2016, right? Obviously it has been motivated by the elusive fundamental particles which are called the neutrinos, to study, to research them, right, and to possibly determine their sources from where they have originated. Okay, the Lake Baikal GVD, right, which is one of the three largest neutrino detectors in the world. Okay, the first one is basically located at Ice Cube in the southern pole, right? The second is basically Antares in the Mediterranean Sea, and it is the third one, or is the third largest neutrino detector which has been installed in the Lake Baikal. Okay, so let's understand the few important information related to the Lake Baikal. So as I told you, the Lake Baikal is basically a rift lake, right? Just like a rift valley, it is a rift lake which has been located in the southern Siberia, Russia. Okay, and it is the largest freshwater lake by the volume, right? By the volume means, if you consider 100% freshwater volume, this Lake Baikal consisting of the 22% of the world freshwater or world fresh surface water, because you have the surface water and underwater, right? So it is the world, 22% of the world's surface water, fresh water, is basically there in the Lake Vaikal. Okay, it is the deepest lake also. It is the maximum depth is around 1642 meters. So you can consider more than 1.5 kilometers depth is there of the Lake Baikal. It is the world's deepest lake. Okay. And it is also the world's oldest lake, which has been, the aged at 25 to 30 million years before. And it is basically a rift lake. It is basically a rift lake. And it is the seventh largest lake in the world by the surface area, right? If you consider area wise, right? And obviously it is an ancient rift valley, right, which have the crescent shape, right, in terms of its shape. Okay, now the region which has been there to the east of Lake Baikal is referred to the Trans Baikal, or it is also referred to the Trans Baikalia, okay, which has been defined as the region around, you know, this lake itself, sometime also called the Baikalia region, which has been precisely referred to the east of Lake Baikal. And UNESCO have already declared the Lake Baikal as the World Heritage Site in 1996 itself for its conservation. Okay, so it is being picturized, the Lake Baikal. Okay, next, the MyNAP 2020. So it is being platform which is known as the MyNAP. Okay, it is been the Union Education Minister have launched this platform, right, of, you know, of NCTE web portal. So this platform, right, would seek, you know, suggestions from different stakeholders, right, for obviously for the preparation of the draft national professional standards for the teachers, right. The center is planning to have the national professional standard for the teachers, as well as the national mission for the mentoring program membership, which is been also known as NMM, right, for the purpose of the drafting of the national professional standard for the teachers and the national mission for mentoring program membership. This platform would seek to have the suggestions from the different stakeholders. Okay, so this platform will be operational from the 1st April 2021 and it will be up to 15th May 2021 for seeking such suggestions from the stakeholders. Okay, and obviously these documents which were in the previous slide, obviously we need the major recommendations. Okay, the NCTC will work in the close consultation with the individuals and organizations for preparation of these documents. Okay, and there will be expert committee who will extensively review the inputs which have been collected during this consultation process, and ultimately it will finalize the draft, right, and this draft would be placed in the public domain for the public review. Okay, and the different stakeholders would be would be taken forward, and their comments will be taken forward, and then the final draft will be made for the notification, and that will be finalized and that will be enforced by the Union Ministry. Okay, then the Joint Logistic Node, right? So what is the Joint Logistic Node? As the name itself suggests, the Joint Logistic Nodes is basically a dedicated, you know, to the armed forces, which will have, right, different type of logistics, like you have ammunitions, rations, like fuel, different stores, supplies, transport, right, clothing, etc. So what will it do? It will basically facilitate the integration of the different armed forces, like be it army, military, navy. So it will facilitate, right, you know, the smooth functioning or integration or integrated command among all three armed forces. So it will be facilitating the synergistic between the three armed forces, right? So Chief of the Defense Staff General Bipin Rawat have operationalized and dedicated to the armed forces the third Joint Logistic Node, which has been facilitated or which has been operationalized in Mumbai. The first two logistics or first two the Joint Logistic Node have already been operational at the two places. One is at Guwahati and second is at Port Blair, and it is the third such Joint Logistic Node which has been operationalized and dedicated to the armed force by the chief of the defense staff, General Bipin Rawat. Okay. And obviously, this joint logistic node would provide the integrated logistic cover to the armed forces in terms of the small arm ammunition, rations to the armed forces, fuel, general stores, civil hire transports, aviation clothing, spares, and also different type of engineering support will also be providing, right, to synergize, you know, the operational effort related to the armed forces. Okay, so it is very important step that the joint logistic node is being set up, right? It is obviously the integration of, you know, the logistic integration of the three services, in terms of the army, okay, the navy and air force. Okay, so to have the integration or logistic integration of the three armed forces is the first such important step. So obviously it will enhance the joint interoperability between these three services. Okay, and the joint operations division, which is basically under aegis of the headquarters of integrated defense staff, would basically enable the establishment of such joint logistic nodes. Okay, and the government already, you know, sanctioned for the establishment of this joint, you know, the logistic nodes, which have been already been set up, right, in Mumbai and Guwahati, right, basically in Mumbai, Guwahati and Port Blair. So two such previous joint logistic nodes have been set up, right, have been dedicated on the October 12, 2020, okay, and which have been sanctioned by the government. And these tri-services command, which have been set up at Andaman and Nicobar Islands, which has been set up at Port Blair, as well as one such joint logistic node is being set up at Guwahati, right? Both of them are operationalized on the January 1st, 2021, and it is a third such node which has been operationalized in Mumbai also. Okay. Next, exercise Santhir or Orgo Sena. The Santhir Orgo Sena means the front runner of the peace. So first of all, you must understand this exercise Santhir Orgo Sena is basically a multinational military exercise. Multinational military exercise means different nations will be participating in the military exercise, which is also known as the exercise front runner of the peace. This exercise Santhir Orgo Sena will be held at Bangladesh, right? This will commemorate the world centenary of the Bangladesh father of the nation, which is being the Bangabandhu Sheikh Mujibur Rahman, which is the father of the nation of the Bangladesh. And it has been also, you know, marked the 50 years of the liberation or the independence from the Pakistan. Okay, so it will mark the 50 years of liberation or the independence also. Okay, now the Indian Army would basically participate in this exercise or in this exercise, right? So Indian Army contingents would comprises of the 30 personnels. These 30 personnel would consisting of the officers, junior commissioned officers, JCOs, and the jawans of the battalion of the Dogra Regiment, right? So the Dogra Regiment would participate from the Indian Army side in this exercise. Apart from that, the contingent of Royal Bhutan Army, the contingent of Sri Lankan Army, and the contingent of the Bangladesh Army would also participate in this multilateral military exercise that will be held in Bangladesh from 4th of April to the 12th of April 2021. Okay, the theme of this year's, you know, the exercise is robust peacekeeping operations, which will be mainly focusing area. Okay, there will also be present from, you know, different countries, the military observers. So military observers from USA, UK, Turkey, the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia, Kuwait, Singapore would also be attending or would also be having the attendance in this exercise as a military observers. All right. So both side you can see, the left one is basically our Honorable Prime Minister Narendra Modi, and right side you have the Sheikh Hasina, who is basically the Prime Minister of Bangladesh. All right, next, the Utkal Divas. So first of all, Utkal Divas is basically, you know, it is a statehood day of ओरिसा, इट इज अ स्टेटहुड डे ऑफ ओरिसा, सो इट इज द 86th स्टेटहुड डे ऑफ ओरिसा विच इज बीन सेलिब्रेटेड एट एज द उत्कल दिवस. ओके, सो इन ओरिसा द नंबर ऑफ प्रोग्राम्स आर बीन ऑर्गेनाइज और हैव बीन हेल्ड टू मार्क द 86th स्टेटहुड ऑफ द ओरिसा. So it has been celebrated as Utkal Divas, which basically commemorate the state which came into existence, in 1936 itself, right, as a linguistic state during the British time. Okay, if you consider or if you want to know more about the history of this Utkal Divas or how, you know, the Orissa as a state came into existence, okay. So you have to study some portion of your modern history book. Okay, so let me give you a brief timeline regarding how the Orissa as a linguistic state came into the picture. Okay, so let's understand first the modern history of Orissa. So British basically occupied the Northern Sarkar, which is currently a part of your Orissa. Okay, so after occupying this Northern Sarkar, which is basically consisting of the southern coast of Orissa, right, it has been occupied after the second Carnatic War in 1760, and this Northern Sarkar, right, is been incorporated into the Madras Presidency gradually over the period of the time. And what happens is in 1803, right, during second Anglo-Maratha War, what happens is the British ousted the Marathas from the Puri Katak region, which was also a part of Orissa, right? And then what happens is the northern and the western districts of Orissa were incorporated slowly into the Bengal presidencies after the second Anglo-Maratha War. And in 1903, right, in order to put forward the demand of the setting up of this Orissa, the Utkal Sammilani organization was basically founded. Obviously, this Utkal Sammilani organization was having the motto or the demand of the unification of the Odia speaking regions, right? The Odia speaking regions are those regions where the majority of the population speakers are basically Odia, or the speakers speak the Odia language into the one state. Okay. And in 1st April 1912, the Bihar and the Orissa province was ultimately formed. And what happens is, in 1st April 1936, the Bihar and the Orissa was split into the separate provinces. So it is the 1st April 1936, the Orissa came into the existence as the linguistic state. So it is the new province of Orissa, which has been unified on the basis of the linguistic basis. That means the Odia speaking the regions have been unified into the single state, which is known as the Orissa during the British rule itself. And the first governor of the newly formed the Orissa was Sir John Ostank Havack at that time. Okay, and after India got independence on the 15th August 1947, the 27 princely states, right, on that time joined, you know, basically Orissa. So they have signed a document to join the Orissa. Okay, so you can see, you know, the clay made very beautiful, you know, the Happy Utkal Divas, which has been very beautifully decorated by the artist, right, at the beach of the Puri. Okay, next, the Shiva Kumara Swami Galu. The Shiva Kumara Swami Galu is basically a spiritual leader. Okay, he belongs to the Karnataka. Okay, so Prime Minister Narendra Modi have vowed to Shri Shiva Kumar Swami Galu, right, on his Jayanti, that means on his birth anniversary. So the Prime Minister Narendra Modi have vowed to Shri Shiva Kumar Swami Galu. About Shri Kumar Swami Galu, he was born in 1907 and he died in 2019, and he was the Indian spiritual leader. Regarding his belief, he was basically, you know, having the faith in the Lingayat religious figure, and he was also the head of the Siddhanga Matha, which is being located in Karnataka, right? And he has been described by most of the people as the adherent of the Lingayats or Lingayatism. Okay, regarding his contribution. He was the well-noted educationalist. That means he have founded the Sri Siddhanganga Educational Society for promotion of the education in the society, right? He has founded over 100 institutions to impart the education to every sections of the society, right? To provide the training, right? Be it, you know, the nursery schools to colleges to the universities, right? For the engineering, science, arts, management, as well as he also opened the vocational training institutes. Okay, regarding the awards and the honors, in 2007, right, the government of Karnataka have awarded him the Karnataka Ratna Award, which has been the highest civilian award which has been conferred on, you know, the Sri, right, to, you know, him by the government of Karnataka. And 2015, the government of India already awarded him the Padma Vibhushan, right? And he was also conferred, or he was also referred, the Nedadunga Devaru, which is basically also meaning as the walking god in the state of Karnataka. So he is highly, renowned person in terms of the spiritual leader, which has been, you know, the professing the Lingayat, right, which has been conferred the Padma Bhushan by the government of India, as well as the Karnataka Ratna Award, which has been the highest civilian award conferred by the government of Karnataka in 2007. All right, so he is basically the spiritual leader. All right, so that's all for today. Thank you very much. We will meet tomorrow for our next current affairs. Thank you.